Welcome, all non-dualists. What we do here is just right emphasis, right emphasis, right familiarity, okay? And this is not gradualism at all. In the classic debate between gradualism and sudden enlightenment, the fact is that all enlightenment is sudden. There's no such thing as gradual enlightenment. But we can gradually accept the fact that there's no gradualism. And that's what the non-dual, non-path is all about. It's the path of no path, the way of no way. It's the goal of no goal. Reality is not scripted at all. There's nothing to judge at all. As Jesus said, judge not lest you be judged. This is extremely profound. How can you judge freedom? There's nothing bound. There's nothing bound to judge, actually. So welcome to the video. We give thanks, all thanks to those who protect our spiritual momentum. I don't know what's going to pop up here. That's not what we want. I had the right picture, but you know, computer programs, you never know what you're going to get. It's like a box of chocolates, which is fine. But all praise the Dharma kings and queens. I've introduced this term, Dharma king, Dharma queen. Dharma, their role is to protect us from spiritual discouragement, protect our momentum towards accepting sudden awakening. All awakening is instantaneous. It's instantaneous awakening. Reality itself is instantaneous. So now, in abidance, we can still have thoughts. It's just that they have no role to play in abidance whatsoever. We realize the world can still be there. It just plays no role in terms of the conventional wisdom or smartness of the world. It just plays no role in abidance. It's like a shadow. It doesn't play any role. So the Dharma protectors, they're here to protect us from spiritual discouragement. And they bring our minds back out of gradualism. Now, gradualism is what we call materialism, process materialism. And there's a reason why these great Dharma kings and queens are back now, is because we're on an event horizon coming up. May 27th is my goal, to be ready by May 27th. This is what I've been told for quite some time. And there's going to be an ideological drop-off. That experience with the wild pigs is very profound, because this represents the materialism, represents the attitude of materialism. And you saw how beastly they were, how animalistic they were. This is how the world is going. Materialism is the great scourge, the great scourge, the great plague, actually. It's the worst plague ever. We're in the worst plague ever on this planet. The more you sink into materialism and you're stupefied. And by the way, this body is just a perceptual device we've imagined to stupefy ourselves, so not see reality. We think we're seeing materiality. Actually, materiality doesn't even exist, but it's an illusion, a misperception. And the sensory apparatus, sensory perception, misperceives. And we have this delusion. So we are going into this materialistic death spiral here in the world, where the people think they're getting smarter, smarter, smarter. But smart is folly. Smartness is folly. Absolute folly, actually. It's wisdom that we need. This is wisdom is virtually extinct here. There's a few wonderful, wonderful people. I know there's some really great non-dualists watching these videos. And so we know what we're talking about here. The trouble that is coming is this is supreme disrespect and stupefaction, and it becomes very defensive. The more we're stupefied, the more defensive we become. Because lies have to be defended from truth, don't they? Obviously, truth exposes the lie. So you go into this negative spiral, very much so negative spiral, and this is what's happened here in the world. I know a lot of people think we're getting smarter. Well, yeah, but that's the death spiral. Smartness is the death spiral. It denies, smartness is gradualism. It denies instantaneousness, denies instantaneous nature of reality, which there's no gradualism to reality at all, actually, none. So that classic debate for instance, in King Trisong Detson's court in Tibet, he invited someone from the Sudden School of Enlightenment, someone from the Gradualist School, and they had a big debate. It was a huge thing, and he decided in the favor of gradualism. This is just a way of being aware that this debate has been going on for a long time. I think that was in the 8th century. But there's no debate. There's no debate. Instantaneousness is the fact. There is no debate. Thinking is always debating. Reason is not debating. Reason knows. Thinking doesn't know. Thinking is gradualism. So when we realize there's no such thing as gradualism, thoughts can still arise, but like a shadow, they don't mean anything. They're just echoes of a false belief in gradualism. And again, hear this through reason. Reason can hear, and it's quiet. It just kind of nods its head, yeah. It says, I know. That's it. Whereas thinking says, let me think about this. Don't think. Don't struggle. Don't try. Don't make efforts. So, we have these powerful allies we need to have an alliance with. So I'm working to forge an alliance for everyone's benefit here. I've worked to forge alliances with these teachers, with Jesus, with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, with Ramana Maharshi, and with Longchenpa. I've worked my whole life to forge alliances with them. So we feel comfortable with their support. We receive their support, we feel comfortable with it, and we can extend it to others. It's very important. We're in this, you know, hideous scourge of materialism right now. And it's a death spiral. So we invite this help. I invite anyone who's capable and willing to help out. I invite them to do so, to help out right now. That was November 2nd, 2013. And that very next night in a dream, what turned out to be Longchenpa, the great omniscient Dharma King, he showed up and, you know, ready to help out. So I've been forging an alliance with Longchenpa for the last several years, right? Yeah. And having already forged alliances with the three other great protectors who protect us from discouragement. Because this gradualism is a supreme discouragement, actually. When you're in it, caught up in it, you're being pulled along by a current, you think, oh yeah, I'm getting more things, more comfort, more posh living. I don't know what good it does me. I can't really eat anything. I really. It's Mother's Day, all this cheesecake and chocolate cake and treats. I can't eat anything. I ate almost nothing yesterday. I gained a pound and a half. I was like, what did I do? It's crazy. So I can't really benefit. I mean, the poshness doesn't really. I mean, we all like beauty. I mean, if there's some beautiful resort, that's kind of nice. But, you know, overall, it doesn't really do much for me at all. But we are caught up in this, and we think that things are getting better for us. The materialists, you know, the pigs, the wild pigs are, wow, they've got a lot of garbage to root around in. You know, that's great. It's hog heaven. A lot of mud to wallow in, garbage to root around in, and they say, they found their nirvana. But the greatest, the worst outcome possible for any of us. The worst outcome possible. There is one. Okay, that is, what is the worst outcome for us? That you know, the, not situation, circumstance, but the most dreaded prospect. What is the most dreaded prospect of all? And it's about another birth, of course. That's enough to make my blood curdle. If I ever want motivation, say, hey, I you know, what if I have to come back here? And that just like sets it like a just a, you know, nuclear reaction in me. And it's like, whoa. That's like beyond hideous, beyond hideous. I mean, just recalling trying to acclimatize myself to this world, it was beyond hideous. And so this just causes my hair to stand up on end, and it like, you know, if I want motivation, all I have to do is say, hey, you know, if you don't do this, maybe you're going to be get a return ticket, and then wow, fire is just, you know, blowtorch of determination. It's just for me, it's like the worst process. Nothing else even can remotely compare to identifying with another body and being born into this world like this, and trying to grow up and trying to make your way in a lunatic asylum. The horrors of this has just been absolutely unchartable, unmeasurable for me. So I beg the Dharma kings and queens to protect me from rebirth, and they say they will. Longchenpa says he won't let me be reborn. He'll protect me from that. So I'm not going to let you be reborn. No way. I'll stand in your way and say, no, you're not doing that. And it's really important to relate to those who have awakened from this false belief in gradualism and process and time and space, and to allow them to help us without having to physically return here. You see how important that is? Because that means that we would will also have some role without having to physically return here. We can help the world. So you see that this is so important that Longchenpa has returned, but he's not physically present as far as I know. He may be able to appear at will anywhere, but as far as being born into a body, I kind of doubt that. But he's giving us immense benefit. From those who are willing to connect with his mind stream. Immense benefit to us. So again, this is our final life, and we certainly want it to be finally go around in this non-life, you might call it, this nightmare. We might think, well, how can I be helpful? Do I have to return to this world in order to be helpful? Well, no. Longchenpa is being very helpful without actually having another birth. You see how that works? Very helpful. Jesus also very helpful. All these teachers. Ramaharshi said he's more helpful when he's not in the body. He's more helpful to us. So this means we can do that too. We don't have to return to this place. No return ticket. So to ward off discouragement is what I'm trying to help with, and it's difficult because I'm not really being that successful or helpful, it seems like. So that's kind of discouraging for me because that's my business. You know, everyone wants to do well at their business. And I'm trying to encourage people. I've came to this world to encourage, don't fall into materialism. You know, this was my purpose. Do not fall into materialism. I want to encourage everyone. Well, look what's happened, you know, just complete collapse into materialism. Very discouraging. So I need the help of these great Dharma protectors to stave off my own discouragement. This is the last thing that anyone wanted to see, what's happened here in the world. It's been a shocker. But you must keep in mind that what we call human nature is intrinsically evil or bad, or meaning it intrinsically goes down into gradualism and materialism. It's a child of materialism. It's an egoic child. And so if we don't make great efforts to free ourselves from this false belief in process and gradualism, we will sink down. And this is what happens. We drop the ball. Materialism, we got distracted by the baubles, the gaudiness of materialism. And we have sunken down badly. You can't drop the ball. We drop the ball. We fumbled it away. And so inevitably, the sensory perception, this deceitfulness gets a hold of us, and we become deceitful, and we believe in gradualism and materialism, and then we become like those pigs, those wild pigs. People are becoming very pig-like, wild pig-like. If you look at their faces, you know, it's just like, huh? I mean, the people here are spiritually illiterate in the world. They're spiritually illiterate to an extreme extent. I don't know, this is maybe the most spiritual illiterate the world's ever been. They're so stupefied by materialism, they don't have a clue. So how could you even reach them? How could you even talk with them? You say, you warn them about getting a return ticket, they look at you like that wild pig. Like, huh? I have no idea what you're talking about. Where's my garbage? I want to root around in the garbage and sit in the mud. You have to be, and so from cradle to grave, we are steeped in materialism and belief in gradualism. Gradual enlightenment. There's no such thing as gradual enlightenment. Well, when we get glimpses, is that gradual enlightenment? No. What that does is gradually evaporates our continuity fear. But that's not gradual enlightenment. Gradual enlightenment's all at once instantaneous. And now when we see glimpses, it's all at once. We see the all-at-onceness, the instantaneousness of it. We see that. And we say, wow. And then our continuity fear jumps up, and we back off of it. And then we wrongly think, well, okay, I'm gradually getting enlightened. No, we're gradually evaporating our continuity fear. But enlightenment is always all-at-once instantaneous. There's no gradualism. Reality is instantaneous. It's never gradual. It's always now. It's always now. So we have to, I advise everyone to forge an alliance with that which is helpful. 1 minute, please. Just 1 second. Yeah. Oh, okay. I advise everyone to forge an alliance. Forge an alliance. The general's here to protect us from discouragement. He faces the foes, the materialistic foes. He's the one, he's out there in front of us facing them and says, just get behind me, don't worry. I will not let them pull you down. This is the most serious business possible. You get pulled into gradualism and you've lost it. And it's so severe now. We're all in danger of losing it. This is what the scripture says. The Bible says that in the end of the cycle, materialism will be so bad that even the saints are in danger of getting pulled into the belief in gradualism. And this is true. That's how bad it is. And so May 27th is starting this cycle now of this death spiral, materialistic death spiral. May 27th, and it will become evident on July 24th, I believe. There'll sort of be an epiphany, like uh oh. So we do have this timetable. This is why we're doing this intensive and pushing things as fast as possible here. I'm trying to make us doing all these beautiful graphics actually. And actually, that helps us. It may seem like a little thing, but subconsciously, it helps us. It helps forge this alliance. We want to forge an alliance. It's very important to us. Because there are Dharma protectors. I mean, Tibetan Buddhism is big on this. They have these, you know, these ferocious deities, but those are protectors. And they have this samaya, this say, don't try to teach this to those who are materialists, because they'll just undermine and sabotage you. They're saboteurs. They're solicitous of your welfare just to find out where you're at, so then they can try to sabotage it. So they understand this. These ferocious deities are really just attitudes of protecting the truth from gradualism. So they know what it's all about. I'm very, very, very impressed by the in-depth understanding they have and recognition of the entire gamut of the situation. It is, you know, like the height of sophistication. They're extremely sophisticated. The top ones who listen to some of their real in-depth instructions, and it's just, my gosh, they have just worked it through and through and through. So they're very aware. That materialism is a bad thing. It's a really bad thing. It's taking the body's senses as truth, as gospel, as what we're perceiving, sensory perception, as reality. This is, you know, just a gross, gross error. And it leads to thinking. Thinking is gradualism, the belief there's no absolute, that there's no instantaneousness, there's no all-at-once-ness, no now-ness. This gives rise then to thinking, what we call thinking, our thoughts, thinking about it. I'm thinking about it. Reality is not thinking about itself. So emphasis, re-emphasis. This is our discipline here. And maybe people think, well, where's my enlightenment? Well, the tides are such that we're trying to be discouraged away from the instantaneousness of enlightenment and being told that the gradual path is the answer. And it's really what we're battling against is simply discouragement and not trying not to succumb to it. Now, if you come into the world, you might be enlightened coming into the world, but gradually you succumb to the discouragement of this world and then adopt a gradualist viewpoint. And now you have to get back to, you know, the all-at-once instantaneousness of abidance. We're not abiding in thoughts, we're abiding in the unscriptedness of reality. The unscriptedness. But this isn't chaos. It's whatever we want is nowness. See, there's no script we have to go through in order to experience something right now. There's no script. We don't say, well, I want to experience this, and say, oh, but there's a script that I have to wait first this and then that and then that and then that. There's no script like that at all. So it's not chaos, it's perfect order, actually. Whatever we order, that's perfectly there for us. Right? Perfect order. Like a restaurant, whatever you want, it's on your plate right now. And whatever you don't want is not on your plate. There's no interference from what you don't want to experience. It's all there potentially. Everything is potentially present everywhere. All possible appearance experiencing is present, omnipresent. So this tree here is both a tree and all other things. As well, all other potentialities. It's just the pure potentiality is just appearing as this tree, but in any instant, it could appear as anything else, actually, in reality. So when you say there's no thing, there's emptiness. Emptiness, like, it doesn't mean a void. It means and no self-nature to anything. It's speaking of what I just referred to. There's no script. whatever is appearing, it's also the total, it's also the non-appearance of all other potentialities, which are also present. So God is present everywhere, which means God is all potentiality of experiencing. It's omnipresent all the time, everywhere. There's no script to anything whatsoever. In terms of, well, in order to be something else, first it has to go through this cycle, like this tree has to go through a life cycle, and it's a tree for this long. And no, there's no such thing as that. That's false life. That's processed. Life cycles is not life at all. Life is right now. It's all right now. And so we have to keep hearing this, because the world has no idea what we're talking about. The materialists have no idea what we're talking about, actually. They look at you like those wild pigs, just... some of the expressions on those pigs, I don't worry, be happy, it's a video. And for me, that's the most stunning video I've ever made. I was just, when I went back, and maybe it's too stunning, because just the visceral animalness of those wild pigs is just, you know, it's so blatant, isn't it? And yet what it is a metaphor for this world, and gets a shock treatment. And the music I put to the good and the bad and the ugly to it, I mean, it's like so powerful. I was shaken after I viewed it. I was just shaken. I said, wow, that is just too powerful. But God gave us this to look at, to see this is what's coming. Okay, this is literally, almost literally, I mean, it metaphorically, very powerful metaphor for what is coming, the piggishness of, well, animal farm, right? Of what's coming in the world. You know, 1984, Animal Farm, those kind of, they said, this is what's coming. Well, it is. It is coming. And a supreme disrespect for spiritual truth is coming. So we need these extraordinary Dharma protectors. Protect our momentum. Now you think, well, if there's no gradualism, how can there be momentum? Well, there's momentum towards recognizing there's no gradualism. Accepting it. Momentum in evaporating our continuity fear. Momentum towards not being discouraged. You see, there is that momentum. So we need this ferocious protection, this great protection, this sublime protection. When I look at the Longchenpa, that statue figurine of Longchenpa, it seems to capture his essence so well. It just this absolute steadfastness, not even the slightest trace of a flicker or oscillation, 100% clear-minded steadfastness, never deceived in the slightest bit, perfect determination, adamant, like gold, pure gold, adamant, this adamant viewpoint, adamant abidance, and wow, yeah. Imagine if your parents were like that when you were growing up and protected you from all gradualism, from all delusion, from all deceit. Of course, no one ever has any such parents. It's mythical. They basically force feed us deceit constantly. Everybody in the world, that's what they do. Are like poultry, and they are like geese for foie gras. They like take a syringe and, you know, pour deceit down our throats. This is what happens here, fattening us up for what? For death, for sickness. To fatten up the wallets of the healthcare industry, which is the new world religion, actually. So don't struggle with your thinking. I always say full stop in the wild means don't struggle with the struggle. The evaporating of our continuity fear is a struggle. Don't then start thinking about it, because thinking will just struggle with the struggle. Just stick with reason. Reason knows the truth. It says, yeah, I know what you're saying. It's obvious. I know what you're saying. So I just have to get, you know, allow the familiarity to set in. Longchenpa is allowing me to work with that statue, likeness of him. I can tell whether there's allowance or not. Like Sri Sri Nanmaiman now doesn't want me working with her pictures. No matter what I do, it never turns out right. Whereas before, she allowed it, and everything I did, it turned out great. It was like just amazing. But now, no matter, I could struggle for an hour trying, and just never, it never comes out right. It is amazing. She doesn't want me to. She wants me working with Longchenpa. Being the ultimate spiritual pragmatist, no spiritual ego, say, do what is effective for you. It's not about me, she says, it's about you. So, but with Longchenpa, everything I do turns out right. In terms of working with this picture, it's just all beautiful. It's all inspiring, all of it. It's not getting, the response that I would expect. It's puzzling. I'm not sure why, but all I can do is, keep on presenting this is forging an alliance. Forge an alliance. This is something we all have to work on. It's like a relationship, right? You get married, or you're dating, you get married. You work on the relationship. You have to work at it. You have to pay attention to it. You forge a relationship in this way, an alliance. Forge an alliance. And I'm working on it every day, and every day I'm having big breakthroughs. And I'm able to see more and more the benevolence that he has for us. And it's very, very, very wonderful. And it's the same with all these Dharma kings and queens, this supreme benevolence and protectiveness. And so try to feel this gratitude. So someone is like there to be protective and has your back. Now they can't do more than we allow. Okay, but they will, if we allow it, they will do everything for us, actually, in terms of protecting us and bringing us to abidance in the true nature of mind. They call it Buddha mind, the mind of natural being. Buddha, natural awareness, Buddha, mind, natural awareness, mind, which is instantaneous mind, now mind, all at once mind. So what we're doing here is we say, yeah, enlightenment is instantaneous. It's all at once, sudden awakening. So let us keep focusing on this sudden awakening. It's sudden awakening. All enlightenment is sudden enlightenment, actually. And get used to this. I always resisted this. It's like, but now I don't. I feel comfortable, more and more comfortable. So this is a challenge for us. Again, we're raising the bar where it should be. Sudden enlightenment is that's the truth. It's entirely sudden. It's all at once. Now, I've been having some very interesting experiences, to say the least. I was up on this high spot, and there was like fog blowing over the top of this mountain and pouring down towards the valley. And you couldn't see more than 100 feet. It was just, all you could see was this gray fog. It's like, wow. And I was dismayed because I wanted to see this view. There's a stunning view from there. And I couldn't see anything. I said, that's really too bad. And so I said, okay, I gotta leave. And I was getting ready to leave. And so I turned my attention away and was rummaging around the vehicle for something. And it was just like a matter of like 20 seconds or something. It was a very, very short period of time. So I lifted my head up and I took one last look. And I was just stunned. It was like the mist had somehow lightened up. And through the mist, like a mirage, there's this incredible vista. She's kind of like appearing, like a dream, like a mirage appearing in the desert. I said, oh my gosh. And then just a little later, that fog lifted enough, and this shimmery, beautiful view of the whole Bay Area suddenly appeared. I was like, It was just jaw-dropping. And then the fog came back and it disappeared. And then it reappeared again. And this went on and on and on many, 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 many times. And I experienced this. My camera, funny thing, I didn't bring my memory cards. I was trying to, but it's not subtle enough to capture this fog. It has trouble focusing when in this fog. So it couldn't have really captured it very well anyway. But for me, it was one of the more spectacular perceptual experiences I've ever had. It's like a dream. Something appearing out of nothing, this spectacular, with the vista, with the bay gleaming, and all the, you know, just the whole thing, the mountains, everything just suddenly, gradually just appeared out of the mist, and then disappeared back into the mist, then reappeared. Wow. All at once, ism, right? There's this gray fog, and then suddenly, the whole vista just there, all there, just like that. And you thought there's nothing there, and suddenly, it's as if you think, oh, there's nothing there to see, and suddenly you're seeing this spectacular vista. You said, where did that come from? Even though I knew it was there, the experience was such that it just like, just all at once, it just suddenly appeared out, almost like out of nowhere. And enlightenment is like that. It's almost like out of nowhere, suddenly this very this sublime nowness just appears. So God is, you know, preparing me for that by giving me this experience there. And I wasn't going to go up there. I was saying, well, you know, it's rainy, it's misty, it's foggy. I can't see anything anyway. Why even go there? And yet I said, okay, whichever direction the traffic's going, I'm going to go that way. And it was going to that up the hill. So I went up the hill and I went there. And I said, disappointed, terrible. See, I shouldn't have gone. And so I turned around and then kabam, there's this awesome, awesome view, and it just almost like knocked the breath out of me. My heart was pounding. It's like, oh my gosh. And again, it repeated itself over and over and over and over. Well, that was just yesterday. The day before that, I was at a stoplight. I heard a kind of a boom. I said, what? And I turned to the left. I looked, and there was this Porsche up on this median island with, you know, there are trees and stuff between, you know, two different lanes, traffic, shrubs, and a concrete curb. It was like half of it was up on this curb, the median island, going the opposite direction of traffic. It like somehow spun around, complete. I had no idea how this happened. A blue Porsche. And I can tell you by the other drivers gawking, they had no idea either. I can't understand what, how does somebody, they were just making a left turn at the light, just going into this next lane. I mean, what did he do? Just like, maybe he just gunned it, you know, maybe stick shift and he just spun out on the wet pavement or something and somehow ended up in this situation completely reversed. How quick, you know, it's like there's going to be like a reversal, severe reversal in the world, very quick like this. It's like, wow. And then I mentioned that my truck, all the electricity in my truck just suddenly went off. But the engine kept running, but nothing else was working. Completely bizarre. I'm having these experiences that are showing me, you know, what's likely to happen. So enlightenment is instantaneous. It's all at onceness. It just appears. Complete in itself. As we let go of our attempt to have more than everything. We try to have more than everything by misrepresenting everything. Okay, that's all we can do. So we're just misrepresenting willfully to ourselves. It's just deceit. Reality is still exactly the same as it's always been. We're just refusing to see it that way. So we're insisting that it's gradualism, process, impermanence. We're insisting on that. There's no impermanence, by the way. Because all potentiality is present everywhere, always. So anything at all could arise endlessly. And if it doesn't arise, that doesn't mean that the it's not still there. Potentially, it's just not an or it's just not ornamenting its own spaciousness, as it were, but it's still entirely there. So you might say everything is permanent, everything is eternal life, actually. So we're tapping into some encouragement here, and I thank those who are helping out with that. Okay, we have some wonderful comments here recently. Some are very good with prose, and some are very good at poetry. And then Bradford Soland, the musician, is very good with music. So this is very helpful for us, is people are lending their talents here and maybe becoming aware of their talents. And I'll see how that goes. And people should be aware of this, that we have some, it's everybody helping out with this discouragement problem is where it's at. Now I keep singing. I practiced yesterday all day. So every day when I'm in the vehicle, I'm practicing. My voice is very weak because it's like working out. It gets tired. We'll see how that goes. If I can just keep doing that, and I'm very sore today and tired because I ran yesterday a lot and worked out. And boy, I feel like a wreck today. But I just try to keep going to May. Up through May 26, okay? We want to just make a big push up through May 26. So, yeah, music, poetry, and prose. And what I do is more performance art, as it were. Holding court, I guess you might say, as my role like a Dharma prince, who sort of an auxiliary of Longchenpa, I hold court. And in the court, all of these talents are very, welcome. These talents are very welcome. This inspiration, these inspirations are very welcome. I do a lot of graphics too, a lot of visual graphics. A lot of eye candy encouragement. Eye candy encouragement. Absolutely. Oh boy, I did. I was up till 2:30 again last night. This is my dedication. 2 out of the last 3 nights, I went up till 2:30 in the morning. The other one, I was up to about 1:30. And I still got to get up. Like 6:30, 7. Today, I finally slept in a bit. But I mean, we have to just push it. So I put everything in Creative Commons, so if other people of inspiration want to use any of this, feel free to use it. That's what it's all about. And I hope that, that's reciprocal. That if I can use something of like Bradford Soland, some of his are Creative Commons. I wish you would put all of them into Creative Commons so I could, utilize and put them as background for some of the videos. I use his Don't Worry, Be Happy. I mean, it's just fabulous. It's just fabulous. I just love his inspirational style. It's very, very inspiring towards nowness. Very inspiring towards nowness. Very, I can't, I don't want to try to describe it. It's just Bradford or Brad Soland has a channel on YouTube called Right Side of the Boat. He also has a website. He plays in assisted living situations for old people who are dying. But we'd like to bring him into the court of the Dharma King here. Of course, he's with the Dharma King Jesus. All praise to Jesus. To say the very, it goes without saying. So bring him into the court here of inspiration, of non-dual truth. Because, I mean, you couldn't have a better court musician than Brad Soland. I mean, he just, his tastefulness is just off the charts. I can't even, like I said, I can't even describe it. I'm not usually stumped musically, but the vibe that he has is just extraordinary. So I try to highlight, I'm trying to highlight his work. Some of his pieces are Creative Commons, not, just there's a few, maybe four or five or something. But really, the ambience, it's just the ambience that he has. The ambience is just, I can just feel it. It's just like really, really, really helpful. Very inspiring and helpful. So we're getting these contributions now, which is a really good development. It's a super development. I see how we can, integrate this into the court. I'm not sure. So I have to look up the name here. Maybe I can do that. Of who is, some of those who are providing these inspirational contributions here. That's great. Again, keep in mind forging an alliance. I have alliances with four Dharma kings and queens. Strong, strong alliances. But I seem to pragmatically function best in the court of Longchenpa. That's why I'm presenting Longchenpa at this point. And some do better in the court of Jesus, for instance. There's a slightly different feel to it, ambience to it. It's very similar, but there's a slightly different ambience to it. Same with like Sri Sri Anandamayi, slightly different ambience to it. And Ram Maharshi, love Ram Maharshi. I can't say enough about Ram Maharshi. I mean, he knocks you into silence, doesn't he? That's his ambience. Yeah. And since I'm somewhat of a talker and sort of adamant, very adamant and fiery and adamant, I tend the court of Longchenpa tends to suit me best for right now. And he's someone that is so very little known to the world, really, that I'm helping introduce him and helping people become aware of this, who otherwise wouldn't be aware that we have this great ally from Tibetan Buddhism. Holy cow. From Dzogchen. That is not fazed by anything, any delusion that's going on. The death spiral is not fazed by it at all. So he says, no problem, I got this. So I'm just trying to look up now the prose. We're getting help in terms of prose from Space of Allowance. Thank you, Space of Allowance. Very talented with prose, with explaining in a prose way. Has a great, great ability at that. There's no question about it. Super helpful. I mean, I go to that and look at it and say, oh, that's what we're saying. That's very nicely, very well said. It helps remind me. And I'm just looking up to get the right. If it will pop up, it's taking its time, which computers usually do. It just doesn't want to. Opening. Okay, there you go. Okay, here's the bard. Wonderful bard. I can even say El Iberocella. El Iberocella. Yeah, El Iberocella. Celta? Celta. El Iberocelta Bard. All right, thank you very much, El Iberocelta Bard, for fabulous poetry. Fabulous poetry. Non-dual poetry. Really great. These are contributions. We're called upon now to contribute to this high super positivity. Some might call it high weirdness, because from the standpoint of the materialist, it's very weird. But for us, it's super positivity. Super positivity. Super positivity. Super positivity, super positivity. We're called to this work of super positivity right now. And okay. Andalusia, Spain, El Iberocelta Bard. Very nice. We just will, more poetry, more non-dual poetry, please. It's very wonderful. It's very wonderful. Let everybody hear it. Let everybody hear it. It's a form of inspiration. And everybody has the uniqueness. They get inspired in different ways here. And so it's a combination. What's important in the idea of a court, in court, is that you've got all these different influences in the court, each adding their uniqueness to make the court very strong. It's not just, and the king is just like the center of the court that makes sure everything, that anchors the whole thing. And the Dharma princes are auxiliaries of the king that can hold court also in a smaller way that extend the ambience of the court. So this is what we're doing. We're establishing a court here, and the positive expressions, inspirations from different angles, that all adds up to strengthen the overall commitment and to banish the discouragement. Banish the discouragement. This is what it's all about right now. So wonderful inspirational sources are coming out of the woodwork here. Really coming out of the woodwork. And I would say put it in Creative Commons if you can, as I do. It just basically public domain, and just share with the court. And if anyone wants to use it in some way, I use it. I haven't contacted Brad. I've just said I comments on his videos, but he maybe I'll ask him. I don't know. Maybe not. To put in Creative Commons, can we? I'll just say, can we use this? I mean, it's like this is helpful. His music is helpful. Fair. I mean, it's really an astonishment. Now it's so unique that little goes a long way. But I listen to it. I say, oh my gosh, it's just, what is this? It seems to be free of so much affectation. It just, it's like lacking all the bad stuff. It's just not there. It's just not there. It's like, wow. Jesus is really, it's really close to Jesus. There's no question about it. It's just lovely. And again, everyone who's contributing, it's just lovely and inspiring. I have graphics that you just don't know. You just don't know. It's just mind blowing. I don't know how to present it. I'll keep trying, but not everybody seems to be helped by that. But it's you have to take it like being struck by lightning. Not struck, but lightning striking nearby. Here's another lightning strike. It's like that. And the discipline of being in the court of the Dharma King is to sit quietly, to sit still, in within abide in within reason, which is really the voice of truth, the Holy Spirit, the voice of reason. And allow these lightning strikes, these thunderbolts, and just say, ah, there's another. Ah, there's another. Now, I put this flower frame around a short excerpt of Longchenpa of this beautiful fountains, and for me, it's just like, wow, there's another lightning strike. It's a short video. It's like only about 2 minutes. But just to, for me, I can feel like as if he's coming from the pure lands, from a reduced intensity zone, from somewhere that is just so sublime that we want it to be now. We feel the unscriptedness of it all. That the beauty is just kind of like, almost like flowing. So these frames are like flowers, or they almost seem like they're flowing. Yeah, it's static, but if you have good graphic imagination, you can feel as if it's alive, and the hummingbirds and bees are moving, and it's flowing, and it can turn into anything else as well. You know, I have some video in mind I can do to share. And remember, the Dharma King is just there to anchor this court, saying, there is a court here, right? A court of banishing discouragement. So he grounds it. He says, I'm grounding it. I'm here. Now pay attention to the lightning strikes. You can use me. So there's the image of Longchenpa there. And yet it's about the sublime that is in the court around him. The beautiful golden fountains, the beautiful light, the palm trees in the distance, and then the beautiful flower frames. It's all evoking a more beautiful, higher realm that is free from this crassness, the wild pigness of this world, the garbage dump that this world, materialistic garbage dump that it really is. So keep being inspired every day. That's your diet. Okay, it's part of your diet. When you want to just say, I want to be in the court of the Dharma King. I want the protection this affords me from the spiritual discouragement. And then realize you have disciplines here. You have a diet you go on, a diet of lightning strikes, you know, lightning bolts, thunderbolts, just wow. A diet of wow. A diet of wow. That's what it's about. Wow, that's inspiring. Wow, that's just, wow, it's just, I've never seen anything like that. Just like with that experience I had yesterday of the vista just suddenly appearing out of nowhere. It just knocked me out. And this song by Brad Soland, the Tucson birders, let me see. Yeah, it just knocked me out. It really did. It really, really did. Let me see if I can find this song. I'm going through his songs right now. Of course it won't show up when I want to find it, right? Yeah, it doesn't show up. Isn't that the way? It's like when you go to a mechanic, you bring your car in and say, okay, it's got this noise, this rattle, and they say, okay, let me hear it. And of course it's not going to do anything. You're not going to hear it. It won't do it. Oh, come on. Just bear with me here. I'm going to his channel here in videos. It's really very... I'm just trying to... Okay, here it is. The Birder's Daughter, a Tucson folk song about growing up in the Arizona desert by Bradford Soland. The Birder's Daughter. Wow. You just don't hear music like this. It's like sort of spiritual folk music with some other, you know, high ambience with heart or something. I don't know. Desert heart. That just knocked me out. I just was floored. And this is what we're going for, okay? We're trying to be knocked out. And what does that mean? We're knocking out discouragement. When we feel knocked out, it's like, discouragement is suddenly, you know, it's gone from us. Like, there's no discouragement. I don't feel discouraged right now. And it's like, what? What is this feeling I'm having? I'm not used to this. What is this? I mean, discouragement gone? Yeah. Oh, well, no, that's my identity. Discouragement is my identity, isn't it? Isn't that our identity? Thinking? Thinking is very discouraging, isn't it? It's entirely discouraging, isn't it? Thinking. It's the worst. It's hell. Struggling with trying to produce gradualism and change reality. That's hell. So when we get knocked out by the positive, by the super positive, it means that we knock out the thinking, we knock out the discouragement. It's just wow. Now people try to do this, the materialists try to do this through sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And we in the court, we don't do that. Okay, that's the wrong path. It's proven to be a very negative path that actually goes into a death spiral. Very bad. Yeah, we know the Saraha tantras, you know, the common people, they said, well, you know, we can do it this way or that way, but no, it's very problematical, to say the least. Highly inadvisable. Extremely inadvisable. We don't do that here. And these are generic terms that encompass a lot, right? We don't dive into the passions like the lowbrow tantras do. Okay, we don't do that here. We don't dive into drugs, and we don't dive into, you know, the rock and rollish, meaning trying to get it from that. Now, there's nothing wrong with listening to a song if it really knocks out discouragement. But you got to be careful that that isn't just animal spirits getting you all pumped up, and from you feel like, you know, sort of invincible. That's not what we're really going for. Like I feel powerful and strong, and I'm all adrenalized and caffeinated, and I can beat the world up or something. That's not really what we're going for here. We're actually going for the whole discouragement of gradualism to be lifted off us like a mist, a fog, just suddenly burning off, and it's just gone. We want the fog of thinking to burn off. So, be careful about that. It's a fine line, and so you know you can confuse the two, and this is what you have to avoid. So, you know, just say no to sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Just say no to it. That's another part of your diet. Just saying no to that. And then a steady diet of real non-dual inspiration, non-dual inspiration. As much as possible. Now, maybe you might have some dessert sometime, like, you know, I might listen to something, a song, and it's like, oh, wow, yeah. But then I realize, probably better that I didn't listen to that. Or I might be thinking, maybe I should watch some sports. No, it's probably better I don't do that. That's not really, you know, what the diet is in the court of the Dharma King. I got a Facebook friend yesterday. I have three now. I don't get Facebook requests. That's a little discouraging right there. Maybe it's a good thing, because the problem is now when you get a friend, all your friends' friends now show up on your feed, which is the stupidest thing ever. I mean, it's like Facebook completely defeating its own purpose. Its whole promise was that you could just control your what shows up on your on in your timeline and your feed to just your friends. And then they completely did away with that, and now you're seeing your friends' friends, which may be people you have absolutely no interest in and don't want their stuff showing up on your feed. It is like the biggest betrayal imaginable, which, I mean, who would have thunk it from, you know, Mr. CEO of Facebook? I mean, are we surprised? No. So what you do is I just, there's a little arrow on the right corner, and just say hide all posts from this person if they show up on your thing. But I mean, it's just constantly you have to keep, you know, I friend this someone, and suddenly all these yoga girls, all their yoga girls show up, you know, on my feed in yoga saunas, you know. So I say, wait, come on, all these materialistic, spiritual materialists show up, and that's like, wow. So anyway, he's in Rishikesh right now and hanging out there doing the Rishikesh thing, which is interesting. We'll see how it is. But generally, Facebook, I have very negative experience with Facebook, actually. Very negative. It's too bad because I can post videos there and graphics that people could, it's a way for people to be inspired, a very good way, but it's just maybe it can catch on. I have so many graphics I can put up and put, some sayings, and this is part of the diet. We need our diet to be a steady diet of wow. Okay, steady diet of wow, steady diet of wow. Well, people have smartphones, use it then to go to like the Facebook page and get this steady diet of wow. Instead, they're getting a steady diet of discouragement. All of this materialism is really spiritual discouragement. Okay, it is plain and simple spiritual discouragement and a loss of spiritual discernment, and it's a death spiral. It's a disaster. It's a plague. And they're not using it. I mean, I have all this great stuff I put up on Facebook. Nobody's ever viewed it because the ego doesn't advise them to. Holy Spirit would advise them, but they're not listening. Obviously, they're not listening. So, I don't know. I just feel like I'm wasting my time posting all that stuff. It's discouraging to me that no, it doesn't go anywhere. But anyway, we'll see. I try. I'm pretty good at bouncing back. I've had to my whole life. I keep bouncing back. I get discouraged and I bounce back and make another effort. And just we'll see what can happen. If there is some Facebooking thing that can spread the court out, so people realize there is a diet. I mean, there's some rules of the court: no sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. You do not dive into that for inspiration. Okay, you did not go in those directions for inspiration. It just means materialism. You don't go that way for inspiration at all, and you don't go to animals basically for inspiration, unless there are some rare exceptions. But be very careful right now. There's a massive, massive push to rely on animals, which is helping people go and get into animal nature. It's quite extraordinary, actually. It's another extreme plague. Wow, it's bizarre. Most conversation around people now, they go to animals. They start talking about their animals, their pets. Now, I've had a couple Dharma cats that were sent specifically to me to help me out, and I understood it, and they understood it. Very unusual. One of them, people swore it wasn't even a cat at all. It was some kind of saint, actually, which was true. It was absolutely true. And the other was just in perpetual bliss, just showing me, the nature of bliss, the bliss of right now. And actually, that cat has shown up in many dreams and actually showed up in the hospital in a dream a number of times, helping out greatly with prayers for us. This cat was some sort of Dharma king or something. Really, seriously. I visit the cat in dreams, and this cat comes and visits me in the house now that it's passed on. It's alive, and it comes in and just spreads this gorgeous, blissful presence everywhere. I mean, it knocks me out as much as like Longchenpa knocks me. I mean, the bliss of this cat is a. Is a Dharma queen or king, or I don't know. But that's how I see it. I don't talk about it as ordinary animal type of thing. Oh, the dog. We got everybody's conversation. My dog this, my dog that. I have to take the dog this or dog. Terrible, terrible sign of collapse, right? So if I talk about the cat, which only very rarely I do, it's in the context of the Dharma of spiritual protector of the bliss of now. So the context goes right into wowness, okay, right? That's what it has to be. The wowness of spiritual protection, of non-dual inspiration. This cat has shown up as much as any of the saints showed up to help, without even being asked. So, occasionally you get situations, but again, you must be very careful because the talk that I'm hearing from everywhere now is people are getting obsessed about animals. It's a terrible, terrible trend, actually. It shows how badly they've fallen. So we don't do animal talk. It's a very slippery slope. I don't speak of that cat, you know, very rarely do I think of it or speak of it. It understands that. It doesn't ask that I do it at all. Very slippery slope. Politics is another very slippery slope. So sex, drugs, rock and roll, politics, animals, those kinds of things are basically banished from the court. Okay, banished from the court of the Dharma King. We don't go in those directions. It's too slippery of a slope. You know, you start equivocating, the tracks are greased, very badly greased, and so there's certain things that you know, yeah, you might walk a tightrope, but it's advisable not to. Why tempt fate? You know, it's stupid. That's just trying to show, well, you're smart. Well, we're not smart, we're wise. Smartness is abomination to us, actually. It really is. Smartness has to do with thinking and delusion. We think, well, again, we think that we're engaged in something that's very complicated, and so we have to be very smart to succeed. No, we're engaged in trying to accomplish the impossible, which is change reality. We cannot change reality, so it's not smart. Trying to change is futile. Smart and stupid are actually false dichotomy. It's just stupid. It's impossible. No, I'm sorry, not stupid. It's futile. It's futile. Smart and stupid is a false dichotomy. It's futile. It's impossible. This is how we see it. It's impossible. So there's no need to engage with our thinking, because thinking posits that it's engaged, you know, in a possibility. Possibility gives rise to thinking. In reality, everything is, all potentiality is omnipresent. So there's no such need to think at all. But when we try to change reality, then we're engaging in plausibility, futility, plausibility, thinking arises. Equivocation, really. See, I can't do it this way, but over here this way, but I can't do it this way, but over here this way. Oscillation, equivocation, oscillation, thinking, all this stuff. Energy, the oscillation of energy. You know, this is a dream. This is the dream. Oscillation. There's no oscillation in reality. Nothing oscillates. Everything is perfectly apparent right now. Clearly. Absolute silence. Free of discursive elaborations entirely. Natural, completely and naturally disposed. So, the more thinking is in charge, the more materialism is in charge, the more gradualism is in charge, the more we believe we're just a human animal, the more we try to hang out with other animals so we can get in touch with quote-unquote our animal nature. This is this animal revival thing that we've been going through for quite some time. Is unfortunately, it came out of the 60s and the 70s of getting back to nature. What really means getting back to our animal nature. They thought that we're just a body. That this perception that shows us the truth of our body and getting back. And so people are now just like obsessed with animals and hanging out with animals constantly. Well, we don't do that. I love animals. Okay. In fact, I'm as kind to animals as anyone you're ever going to meet. I don't harm a fly, not even a mosquito. Always treat animals with great kindness and respect. Try to treat everything that way. But I don't try to hang out with animals and try to, this lean on them as my guide. No, I avoid that. I avoid that. Stay away from it at all costs. We hang out with the wow of non-dual inspiration. Yeah, you don't want to try to do both. That's a problem. When I was younger, I grew up with animals. We always had numerous animals around. And I can tell you that pulled me down very badly. Very, very badly. It's an extremely bad thing to do. You get attached to the animals, and we had ducks and rabbits and guinea pigs and cats and dogs, and we had a fox for a while. We had tortoises, we had fish. We just had every kind of pet you can imagine, and multiple, never a time when we didn't have cats. My whole life we've always had cats. Most of the time we always had a dog or two. And rats, many rats, mice, rats, and this is was actually a terrible thing. Very bad. Very, very bad. Now, if they think, well, the kids like it because the antics are amusing and all the stuff the kids. Well, sure, it's easy for the kids to get into that. But what happens is it entrains you. You start thinking in animalistic ways. There's no question about it. I can speak from my own experience. It's a very, very injurious thing. And I know people might get very upset about that because there's this whole idea of animals as companions for us. But you know what is a better companion is the court of the Dharma King is a way better companion, and it requires discipline and determination, and it brings out the best in us. Hanging out with animals is a big no-no, actually, on the spiritual path. You never see on the spiritual path in history ever them saying you're supposed to hang out with animals. In fact, they never even address the topic. It's extraordinary. I've never come across anything that addresses the topic of animals, because you just didn't hang out with animals in the past, really. And now it seems like the world is completely cuckoo for animals. We're not animals, okay? We're divine spirit is freer than the wind. Absolutely free, completely formless, intrinsically formless. We are absolutely, totally sublime in every possible way. And we are just pretending. We have this silly, silly game of trying to misinterpret reality and claim that through misinterpreting it, we can have a vision of a better reality. We can do something better than reality. Because we're misinterpreting it and say, oh, this isn't so great. We can do better than this. It's like having a dream of reality and then taking the dream to be real and then say, wow, I don't like this dream. This dream's not that good. I can make create something better than this. And that makes as if that makes us a new prime creator, creating something better than what God created. We're just reacting to our dream. And by the way, all these thoughts we have, they're our own thoughts. We don't have to be enslaved by our own thoughts. We're the one in charge of our thoughts. We're the one thinking our thoughts. We don't have to be bullied by our thoughts. That's so stupid. When you start seeing this, you're just astonished. You're like, wait a minute. All this is just my thoughts, my thinking. And I'm bullying myself through this thinking. I could just stop all the thinking. Just like that. What are you bullied by this? It's so absurd. It's completely absurd, isn't it? And I'm starting to see this. I just said, wait a minute. That thinking I'm having of being bullied by materialism, those are just my thoughts. So who's having these thoughts? I am. Well then, can't I stop these thoughts? Yeah. I was like, what? I don't have to have these thoughts. I don't need any resolution. I'm just making up these thoughts. I don't need the thoughts to resolve somehow or come up with something. Not at all. I just stop them right now. Just stop them right now. I don't need these thoughts to be what I am. I'm not a thinker. I'm a beer. I'm an iser. I'm not a thinker. Descartes, I think, therefore I am. No, I think, therefore I'm stupid. It's just really. I mean, Western empiricism is so utterly messed up. It is the Antichrist of materialism. Absolutely. I think, therefore I am. What nonsense. I think, therefore I'm deluded. I think, therefore I'm self-deluded. There, fixed it for Descartes. I've come across a couple websites that have been very helpful for me, for my work, which is a blessing. I'm still waiting on one to make some adjustment they need to do. They'll help me out, and hopefully it'll come soon. It'll give you some beautiful graphics, and I'd probably put some music with it. And again, it's part of your diet. Just think of it like that. Is you're on this diet. That's all. And be dedicated to this diet. It pays off in the long run. Just like I've been on this diet, and you go up and down, but overall you keep losing weight, and you know, you get in better shape. And at some point, you're just like, you know, wow. I was like trail running yesterday, which is why one of the reasons I'm so sore. It's a whole different type of running than just plodding along on some asphalt street, isn't it? It's, you're going from side to side, dodging all the potholes and bumps and rocks and stuff, and you have to use your ankles and the whole agility and balance of your body. So it's a really supreme workout, trail running, especially on uneven trails that require a lot of agility. But boy, am I feeling it today. I just ordered some trail running shoes, actually, off eBay. I got some, yeah. I can't afford to buy new stuff. I have to go to eBay, which doesn't always work out well. Sometimes it works out well, but sometimes not quite what you want. But generally, I've recently done pretty well. So you know, got them real cheap. They look like they're in like perfect condition, and yeah. So I'm really looking forward to that in doing some trail running. That shows you dedication. That's just physically, okay, you don't want to just do nothing. You can if you want. That's fine. If that's what is good, then that can be really positive too, where you just complete silence, just sit. I did that for a long time. That's very good. But physically, if you want to do something, just, you know, stay focused on improving your flexibility and your agility, I would say. Flexibility, agility. Drop some weight. Eat real healthily. Eat less food. Less food. Which is what I'm doing. Thin down, lighten up, flexible, agility. And then, but your primary focus is always on today. To say, God, just, I want you to knock me out today. Not just once, but all day long. As much as I can bear, God, just knock me out. Non-dual wise, okay. Non-dual wise. Now the materialists, they have ways to try to knock themselves into materiality. They're trying to get knocked out into dualism. So they have like pornography and drugs and you know, heavy rock, whatever, you know, you want to call it, whatever the music they listen to. Or I mean, heavy rock's not necessarily bad, but it just certain, you know, the music can really pull them into that. It just, you know, the whole animal thing. They try to be knocked out into duality, knocked out away from non-dual, into duality, into materialism, into this nightmare of impermanence and death, this false, this self-deceit, this arrogance, this continuity fear. So we want to be knocked out into non-dual knockouts. Non-dual, knocked out, non-dually knocked out. And so if you're a knockout artist, you know, bring it. Bring it. That's what I do. I'm a knockout artist, you know. That's what I do. Some are good at aphorisms. We've had some here that are very good at aphorisms, absolutely. Right? Non-dual aphorisms. That's very helpful. Then we have some that are very good at just general encouragement here. Consistent general encouragement or general interest. That's part of the Dharma, the court also. Sort of everyday encouragement. That's very helpful. And then the others do the aphorisms. So there's a mix in the quarter. You know, there's everyone has some slightly unique uniqueness to it. And we're not in too much of a hurry in terms of as we sort of spend our time here. So just going over, let's see. We're getting all close here to 1,300 subscribers, and close to 500,000 views here. That's very nice. Hopefully, we can double that quickly. So we have the very unique talents of Energy Vortex 1000. Very inspirational, to say the least. And then we have the great Eora Ia. It's hard to pronounce the first name. Eora, I guess. Ia, who's everyday kind of encouragement and support every day. And then we have, of course, Jimmy, who's great at the aphorisms. Who's good at saying it just right. Excuse me. And then Inga Vilnius, who's very good at encouragement. Very good at encouragement, positivity. And so we have these regulars. Oh, J. Otis 92. Jimmy Otis 92. Very, very good at just saying the right thing at the right time. A genius at that. The right thing at the right time. Super talented at that. And so, yeah. We have these positive, super positive influences here. This constitutes this helps the Dharma court. This court of spiritual protection from discouragement, it helps it out greatly. So keep it going and bring it. You know, bring it just and keep yourself focused here. We have to stay focused in this intensive build up. We have about less than 20 days now. To maybe 19 dates to May 27th. May 27th, I just feel, is a very good date to aim for, where we want to have this Dharma court up and running in some way. So what do I need to do? How to organize this? It's just, I don't know. I can't come up with, I don't have the answers for it as far as how to extend the court like this. You know, bit by bit, we're doing it. Maybe we can make some jump forward somehow. But this is the idea, is contributions from multiple sources. And the Dharma King was the one who basically is in charge of the court, and if something is not quite right, they say, no, okay, not now, maybe later, but maybe this isn't quite what we need at this point. And they make sure that it stays the way that it needs to stay, keep everything spick and span, because of course we all still have some rough edges to us, don't we? Yeah. So sometimes I do something, I say, it's just not quite, good enough, and let's see if I can do something better here. Or maybe that's influenced by more materialism or dualism. Don't so let's not go for that. So bad habits, don't bring them into your day. The good habits, bring them into your day. The bad habits of being knocked out into dualism, don't bring them into your day. The good habits of being knocked out into non-dualism, bring those into your day. Really simple, isn't it? Just like that. Just like that. Now, Longchenpa asked me to be a Dharma prince because I can play that role. So I'm trying to get see what that role is. And getting into that, and it really is just it's helping just extend the court, you know, like that. It's that's what it is, and a number of qualities you have to have. It's a responsibility. So again, you have to use discipline to not walk on a tightrope about those issues that are a very slippery slope, just to prove, you know, how clever, smart we are. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. So it's, there's certain things that, that tend to go in the wrong direction quickly, and so we just have to stay away from those. It's not. It's not a. You know, it's just that. It's just that I'm aware that they have a, there's a tendency to easily go in the wrong direction. You start out, seems to start out well, and then before you know it, you're people like talking about your body and medicines and medical procedures. Yeah, you know, that's a no-no. Yeah, you know, you just don't do that in the court. You don't talk about your body very much. I mean, you know, diet a little bit maybe you can talk about, because we do have to eat, and maybe some exercise, but try and you know, that can go in the wrong direction too pretty quickly. So a lot of people, that's all they want to talk about, right? But it's like the weather. You can maybe talk about, okay, but no, don't overdo it. It's a pretty slippery slope there too. So we just a whole lot of stuff that the materialists talk about, we don't talk about. We don't talk about entertainment, movies. We don't talk about movies. We don't talk about entertainment. We don't talk about any of that stuff. That's all very much banned in the court of the Dharma King, because it's injurious to the ambience. We're trying to build up a super positive ambience, which is necessary to ward off this horrible discouragement, which again is worse than the bubonic plague. It is, you know, a million times worse than the bubonic plague. So if people took that seriously, we better take this even more seriously. It's very serious. And of course, the materialists don't take it serious at all. They say, what do you mean set up a court? That's ridiculous. We don't need anything. Everything's going great. Well, yeah, going down the toilet, just great. But, you know, for those who don't want to go down the toilet, it's going terrible. Circling the drain, great. But we don't want to circle the drain. So they don't. They think our seriousness is just totally weird. I mean, what do you do? What do you... They think, oh yeah, we're finally getting in touch with our animal nature, and this will make us happy. We don't have an animal nature, actually. Human beings have never existed. We've never been born, actually. Reality is birth-free entirely. It's only eternal life present everywhere. Nothing is ever born and nothing ever dies. So the core of the Dharma, King, again, is a situation where you put yourself in for the encouragement and to protect yourself from discouragement. It's just a smart, really, well, not smart, it's a wise move to make. And you get used to it. You get used to it dwelling in the court. You have this diet. Some things are banned from your diet. Some things are encouraged on your diet. Just like a normal, on a diet, you ban the sweets, or you ban something. You ban the fatty fried foods or the starchy stuff, whatever. You just can't go there. So it's just a discipline. Again, if we don't discipline ourselves, we'll fall by the wayside. Ramana Maharshi said, nobody's ever succeeded without very, very determined effort. He says, we are not born with the birthright of controlling our thoughts and our mind, or getting free of that. He says, we are inclined, as we come into this world with our habits of attention, we're inclined to self-deceit, self-delusion, deceit, mental deceit. This is, and so he says, you have to make a very, very determined effort. He says, there's no exceptions. Everyone has to do this. So it's required. You have to make like on a, just like a diet, exercise and diet program. You have to do the effort. There's no way around it. And it's discipline, self-discipline. I'm just going for the wow. So all day long, this is what I try to do. I guess I'm supposed to pick something up for somebody, so I have to do that. But all day long, I'm just praying and asking to be knocked out in a super positive way, and working on that. And just, this is the diet we need to be on now, if we don't want to get pulled down by discouragement. The discouragement is going to be simply so bad, I can't even explain it. So we need help that is so super positive, we can't explain it either. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. If the discouragement is inexplicably strong, then the encouragement needs to be inexplicably strong as well. And we're not going to get caught up in trying to the game of explaining. It's just right now, it's a plague, and you don't, your house is on fire. You don't try to explain the chemical compositions of the flame or something. This is obviously a delaying device. It's just we need inexplicably powerful super positivity, inexplicable super positivity, to counteract this inexplicable negativity, discouragement. Right? Absolutely, we do. So I keep on produce trying to, we let us all redouble our efforts and contribute to one another. This is what it's about. It's not just one person, doing it. It's everybody contributing. Non-dual inspiration. This is what it's about. All right, very great. That's it. Now I'll get back and keep doing more and more and more. Full stop in the wow. When the wow arises, remember, give yourself opportunity to catch your spiritual breath. The super positivity knocks the breath out of us, right? It like shaking. You're just like, wow. I didn't realize how beautiful the mind is. It's so sublime. Oh my gosh. Wow. It's right here, right now. Oh my gosh. I could be experiencing this right now. Oh, that is true. I could be experiencing the sublime nature of Buddha mind right now, this very instant. Christ mind. Wow. So give yourself an opportunity to keep breathing into that and just say, yeah. Okay. But don't struggle. Don't subtract from it. Don't add to it. Just let it, let the shock, let the lightning is struck now. Settle. Let your nerves settle. Let your nerves settle. Full stop in the wow. Very great. That's it.